Amen. Selah. You may be seated. Hallelujah. Well, continuing on the new season, we are got a couple more weeks left until Pentecost, Shavuot. Shavuot is coming up, I believe, the week prior to Father's Day, I believe it is. Father's Day is coming up. Yes, and so I think Shavuot comes in on that Saturday evening, the week before Father's Day. So we have a couple more weeks while we're talking about this new season, because remember, without a Passover, we can't have a Shavuot. So without being saved, we cannot have relationship. And we're talking about the power of a new season, but the power of the new season depends on relationships. So one of the most important things that we need to understand is that we need to keep intact our relationship. And that relationship might be demonstrated through church attendance, tithing, commitment, all those. But we also know that that can be done without relationship, honestly. And so that really, though it looks like it would be a relationship, you and him only know what kind of relationship you have with him. By the fruits we will know them, because it will come out in character. It will come out in the way that you handle and what you say a lot of times, because that we cannot hide a lot. We can hide a little bit, but when the pressure is put on us, those things come to the surface. And so we're talking today, and we've been talking about throwing off those things which hold us back. And tonight I want to talk about being delivered from trashy traditions. Trashy traditions. And I hope that you all brought your trash can so you can put them in there by the end of tonight. And, of course, we've been using Acts chapter 2, 1 through 2, just to let us know that the festival of Shavuot has arrived and that this whole thing gears towards Shavuot. But I want us to also look at Colossians chapter 2, verse 8, because Colossians chapter 2, verse 8 tells us, watch out. Everybody say that with me. Watch out so that no one will take you captive by means of philosophy and empty deceit, following human tradition, which accords with the elemental spirits of the world but does not accord with the Messiah. A couple things I want to point out before I move on from this scripture. Those words, watch out, is a commandment. It is a declaration. It means when someone says, watch out, what is coming to you? Danger, Will Rogers, danger. Danger is coming to you, okay? And so he wants you to know that one of the most dangerous things that you will encounter in your walk with him is the challenge of whether you follow him and the word or whether you give in to tradition. Because he already knows that tradition will be so steeped in your life that you will have to make some choices, and some choices will be hard to make. So he tells us, watch out. Let no one take you captive. Captive is also another strong word, because when you're held captive, it means you cannot get free. And all of us who've walked this Torah life and have been challenged by some of those traditions, you didn't realize how captive you were, how imprisoned you were to that tradition until you realized the fight, either to hold them on, to hold on to it, or even the fight dealing with all those that are holding on to it and you want to try to walk away from it. It's there. It's there 24 hours sometimes. It's there in your job. It's there in your families. It is there. And tradition doesn't just mean the big ones. Traditions can be just traditions, things in your life that you do, that you will do in spite of the Word of God, or traditions that you will do even though the Word of God says not to, because it's a tradition. And he says that these human traditions, which accord with the elemental spirits of the world, and what's the next part says? Say, but does not accord with the Messiah. And that word accord means walk with him. They were in one accord. So that means these spirits of the world, these traditions, do not and are not in unity with the Messiah. So basically, we need to gauge ourselves not by the traditions, not by what we know, but by the word of Adonai, which is the importance of the word of God, because it's alive and energized, right? And able to discern both soul and spirit, marrow and all those things in your life that maybe will be brought to light that you have to be challenged in. So traditions are built on past rituals which continue from generation to generation. And a lot of times those traditions that you've been doing for 20 years, when it intersects with the Word of God, which means the Word of God is going a different direction, it's a challenge, especially since it's been there all your life. And when you decide to go down a different road, how many know that might be easy for you, but those who is intersecting in that road that's never seen you go down a different road, that really throws them. So what happens is when we understand these very powerful past rituals and what power they have in us is that they actually develop mindsets. Everyone say a mindset. These mindsets can sometimes become so strong that even truth cannot even penetrate that false perception of life. They become so strong. And sometimes when you sit down and you know someone who has a tradition and you're trying to show them the Word of God, but it says this in Genesis and it says this in Malachi and it says this in Ezekiel and then it says this in Matthew, and they look at you like they have no idea what you're talking about and that what you're speaking is gibberish to them, it's because of the mindset. And all of us have mindsets. Some of us had mindsets that it's like, and I'm sure your parents said it to you and you've said it to your children, it's talking to you is like talking to a brick wall. I'm sure husbands and wives had either said it to each other or thought it, right? Because a mindset is very, very powerful. You can show them this, you can show them this, you can show this way, you can show that way, and guess what? Their mindset. It's set. And so when Yeshua refers to traditions in the Word, it normally really is in the form of a rebuke. When he talks about those traditions, it's usually in the form of that rebuke. And that's because traditions produce a stubborn mindset that is stronger than that person's ability to receive the Word of God and be set free. Stubborn to the end. Stubborn like a bull. Won't get it, don't want to hear it, don't want to receive it. It's like shutters on your eyes. You just see it gone. Like earmuffs been put over the ears. They act like they're listening to you, and you think you're giving a great word. I mean, I've been in like counsel sessions and talking to my children, and you're just thinking, wow, they're going to get this because it is like coming from heaven. And nothing. You know what I'm saying? You're just waiting, and you're like, okay, when they leave this house, when they leave, I'm telling you what, they are changed. And if someone called, you'd be like, I talked, and I'm telling you, the Holy Ghost came. And I'm telling you what, they are changed. And guess what? They went to the bedroom and changed the clothes, and that's all the changing they're doing, and they went back out. Many times in church, we place traditional value above our own purpose, which is actually to meet the people, introduce them to Yeshua, and get them set free. That really is the purpose of God in our lives, right? Go into all the world and preach the gospel, teaching them to observe all things, right? Baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, right? That is the mission. That's the purpose. And even a lot of times, those traditional things get in the way of really what our purpose is. And when we get to that place where we have that mindset, there is a self-righteous mindset that actually is identified, because that mindset, especially when it comes to the things of God, you have this self-righteousness, and that self-righteousness can dim your own flaws while illuminating the weaknesses of other people. Because you're right and they're wrong always. Always. You'll listen to them, I see it, you're wrong. Okay, show me, you're wrong. It's self-righteousness, and we got to be careful because, you know, as much as I have learned over the years, I still know that I have not learned at all. And even probably in areas of my life that I have kind of gotten to a place of leveling out, probably in a couple of years, I'll have to pump it up again. You know what I'm saying? That I will have to say, well, I shouldn't have leveled out there. There's a little bit more information that's coming my way. We should be learning to the time we are on our deathbed, right? And when you stop learning, you become self-righteous. Well, let's look at Mark chapter 7, verses 1 through 5. The Pharisees and some of the Torah teachers who had come from Jerusalem gathered together with Yeshua and saw that some of his Talmudim ate with ritual unclean hands, that is, without doing the nitalat yadayim. For the Pharisees and indeed all the Judeans holding fast to the tradition of the elders do not eat unless they have given their hands a ceremony washing. Let me stop here for a moment, because a lot of people, when they read this chapter, they think that actually there's coming against Yeshua because they were eating unclean food, and so it's all right to eat unclean food. But in reality, what it's talking about is just the washing of hands before you eat kosher food. Just the washing of hands. And so it says also, when they come from the marketplace, they do not eat unless they have rinsed their hands to the wrist. And they adhere to many other traditions, such as washing the cups and the pots and the bronze vessels. And we all know, if you've ever been around or studied about a kosher kitchen, it's a lot of work to keep a kosher kitchen according to the oral law. So that means when you go in to the fellowship hall from here to there, if you did not stop to wash your hands, you are unclean. Well, with one bathroom, that would be a very long process for us, right? So the Pharisees and the Torah teachers ask him, why don't your Talmudim live in accordance with the tradition of the elders, but instead eat with ritually unclean hands? So the Pharisees were quick, actually, to point out the blatant disrespect to the tradition of the elders. It was a tradition of the elder. It is a oral law. Doesn't mean that it's a wrong oral law. Doesn't mean that it's not good to do, because you tell your children, did you wash your hands? Go wash your hands, right? And you might even say to them, you're not eating until you wash your hands. You see your hands? How filthy your hands are? Go wash your hands. Are you sure you wash your hands? You didn't wash your hands. Go wash your hands. It's a tradition. It's not a bad tradition, but it's not a tradition to the level that you are breaking a commandment of Adonai. So Yeshua recognized that they were trying to discredit him, because it's his disciples. And so what they were saying is, you are allowing your disciples to break the traditions of the elders, which means we discredit you. And Yeshua wanted them to know, this is not going to discredit me, because it's not a commandment of my Father. It's a commandment of the fathers, but not a commandment of the Father. All right? And so in Mark chapter 6, 6 through 13, he replies. Yeshua answered them, Isaiah was right when he prophesied about you hypocrites. That's nice how to start a conversation like that, right? As it is written, these people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far away from me. Can I stop here for a moment and just say, if you looked at them, it looks like they're honoring God. They're church people. They're people who say they know God and are honoring God. They honor God in the way that they honor God, right? They honor God in the traditions of men. But look what he says. But their hearts are far away from me, for the simple reason they would rather do the traditions of man than the word of God. And that is the difference between someone who honors him with their lips and someone who knows him with their heart. Their worship of me is what? Useless. Let me point it out. Is it worship? Yes. Does he recognize it as worship? So you can't tell someone you're not really worshiping God. What you need to say is you're worshiping God, but it's useless. And the reason why it's useless is because they teach man-made rules as if they were doctrines. As if they were doctrines. So their complaint about dirty hands when their own hands were spiritually filthy. The Pharisees were at a place where they were coming against the disciples and Yeshua, and they wanted the disciples to be punished for disobeying that tradition. But Yeshua pointed out their hypocrisy. So they're rebuked for laying aside that commandment, but actually it's not a commandment. And so Yeshua rebukes them for laying aside the commandment of God. Now, the power of tradition, okay, is very powerful in our lives, because the power of tradition should never be stronger than the power of God that's residing within us. Never should be any stronger. If you find yourself finding the Word of God, and you read that Word of God, and you know that it's against maybe a tradition, there should never be a challenge. If you read in the Word of God, and then there's a tradition that, and actually in the Word of God, that comes against that tradition that you are doing, there should never be a challenge of which one is right. Is it my tradition or is it the Word of God? The Word of God should always rule and reign in your life. It really should be easier for us to throw things off. But actually, it's harder for us to throw things off for some reason. And, I mean, just let me give you an example. What if, right now, the government passed a law stating that everyone had to bow down to other gods during certain times of the year, despite your religious beliefs? This is what you had to do. It was a government mandate. What would we do? What would you do? We would honor God. We would be appalled by it, right? We would have protests. It would break out. We'd probably have rallies. There'd be an uproar, you know what I'm saying? And we would just cause a fuss. However, it doesn't take very long for the traditions of men to masquerade as religious piety and devotion. If we look at Exodus chapter 32, and we're not going there, so don't get scared that we're going to read the whole chapter. But in Exodus chapter 32, we know what the story is. The story is about children of Israel coming to the place. Moses goes up and stays longer than the people wanted him to. And so then what happens is they come to Aaron, and Aaron says, okay, let's do this. And they grab their gold, and they create and melt it down, and they create a what? A golden calf. And what that did was is that the children of Israel introduced a golden calf into their worship service. It wasn't separate from God. It was part of being God. And that's where God doesn't. He doesn't like things mixed. It's either his or it's not his. It's either sweet or it's either bitter. It's either right or it's wrong, right? It's either holy or it's unholy. You're either a believer or unbeliever. You're either a Hebrew or a Gentile. It's the way it is, right? And so Aaron leads the people, the people of God, to devise a new tradition. And what he was doing was, it was substituting man's God for an encounter with the true God. And we see that has happened a lot. Now, again, just because it's very familiar to us, Sunday is actually a tradition of man. Whether you follow it or not, it's still, we recognize it's a tradition of man. And what do we do on Sunday? What did we do on Sunday? We worshiped God. But it's a tradition of man, right? And Saturday or Sabbath is a commandment of God, not a tradition of man. And so when we were learning, I had to decide which one we needed to go with, the tradition of man or the commandment of God. And when we have the tradition of man and then bring God into it, we are actually substituting. And let me just say something to you. You can't substitute God. And so since that moment, actually, the times and what the people of God have been doing is that we've been substituting God with our own traditions. We've been substituting different things, and we've been transforming this encounter with God into our own likeness, what we want and what we feel is him, what we see him to be. And actually, he's very plain of who he is. In our world today, man's traditions have become religious rituals that are substituting for a relationship with Yeshua. So what we have is many Christians who would never accept a government-mandated law to bow down to other gods, however, do it all the time. We say that we wouldn't, but we do it all the time. Did you? Were you going to say something? Oh, okay. I didn't know you were like, hallelujah, or I was stretching, or look at the stars. Right. Right. And what does he do? He desires obedience rather than sacrifice. Look at Daniel chapter 3, verses 1 through 6. Nebuchadnezzar the king had a gold statue made, 90 feet high, 9 feet wide. It's a pretty big guy. We basically know the story, and the story is he creates this thing, and if we look down verse 4, and he heralded, proclaimed, peoples, nations, languages, you are ordered that when you hear the sound of the horn, the pipe, the harp, the zither, the lute, the the bagpipe, they must have been some Scottish people there, and the rest of the musical instruments, you fall down and worship the gold statue that Nebuchadnezzar the king has set up, and whoever does not fall down and worship is to be thrown immediately into a blazing furnace. Well, the thing is that many of us, many believers, have developed mindsets that are that have opened them to receive actually false teachings. Because when we understand the story and continue to read the story, there was very few people who didn't bow down. Namely, three little Hebrew boys, right? So you can imagine when, you know, when we look at five virgins, five are wise, five are foolish, when we go through and see some of the percentages that we've talked about, 3,000 were saved, but only 150 landed in the upper room, and we see that there's a smaller percentage that really follow. So what we see is the masses are actually following, and very few, in percentage-wise, would stand up against what was being proclaimed for them to do. The thing is, and one of the reasons why, is because when you stand up for what you believe, you will always come under fire. No pun intended, but also look at this as a real story, but also a spiritual, allegorical parable that we can look for our own lives and see that there is a fiery furnace waiting for you when you stand up for that which is the Word of God. And will be hotter as the society continues to go on, because we see it getting crazier and crazier and crazier and crazier and crazier. Right? I mean, when we're fighting over bathrooms and creating things, I mean, we're just getting crazy. Woo! We're going down the hill fast. Right? And what I find to be very interesting is and I said this, I think, to Line of Judah too, is that what astonishes me is the blindness of people that seem to be flowing right with it. No one's throwing out an anchor. No one's trying to stop it. No one's kind of dismayed. And I'm talking about even our generation. I mean, some of the older people are like, well, then that's good. We should love everybody. I mean, okay, I get that we should love everybody. But I don't want to be in the bathroom with everybody. I mean, just personally, I don't. Okay? And so I find it to be interesting. So I would find, if we went back to Nebuchadnezzar in Daniel chapter 3, it wouldn't be a hard sell to see why all the people and nations would just do it, except for just three little Hebrew boys. See, when the fire hits, the challenge becomes two things. The challenge becomes this. Are you willing to risk being thrown into the mental an emotional fiery furnace of your accusers? Because they're not going to create a fiery furnace right now and put you in it where you're going to have to look for the fourth man. It's mental. It is emotional fiery furnaces. It's the way your family looks at you. It's the way your friends talk to you. It's what your coworkers say to you when you make the stand. It's when you say no to them and they begin to say, well, I can't believe that this is, you know, what you're doing, and you must hate me, and I don't know what God would you have that would cause us to be separated, and I can't believe it. You've been part of my life all my life. What is that? That's mental and emotionally fiery furnace. And you have to be willing to say, I appreciate all that you're saying. I love you, but I'm not bowing down to the Nebuchadnezzar that you're asking me to do. And if I have to go through the fire of your mental and emotionally fiery expressions and accusations, then guess what? I'll have to handle that. But the thing is, are you willing to risk that? Because again, the challenge becomes that when the fire hits, it's easy when everyone still loves you. If every time there was a situation, you a situation was going to come up, whether with coworker, with a family, with a friend, whatever, that's the moment you went on vacation so you would not have to deal with it. You would never be challenged. But guess what? You can't vacation every week. As much as we would like to do it, you can't. You know, when someone, can you, oh, I'm on vacation. No, this is the Sabbath. And I said this. Here's the thing about, and I'm just, for me and Sister Gail, because I'm going to talk about us for just one moment. The commandments for us, and I'm sure other people, but I'm just saying for us because I live with her and she lives with me. The commandments for us are not just commandments that we know. We possess them. And what I mean by that is we would never not do Sabbath. We would never eat anything that's unclean. And only for the simple reason, these are not commandments that we pick and choose. They possess us. I could not do it. I'm possessed by obedience to him. Now, I'm not saying I'm perfect in every operation of my life. Come on. I knew you're all thinking it anyway, so I just go ahead and acknowledge it. But here's the thing. I'm possessed by it. I want that to possess me, to live. It's part of my life. It's not something I can pick and choose. It's part of me. It's like my hair color, my original one. This one. I don't know what you're all thinking. It's what I live with. It's what we live with. I never have to ask Gail, are you coming to Sabbath? She possesses it. It never even crosses my mind. Not at all. I'm not going to say, are you sure they are turkey pork chops? Never crossed my mind. Or never, because we possess it. We understood it. We read it. We want to do it. It's very easy to do. Right? So it's just something that flows with us. So we are willing then to be thrown into the mental and emotional fiery furnace. And I've been thrown in that just recently. One of my siblings said, can you come up for this thing on, and it's going to be on Saturday. I said, I can't come on Saturday. Why can't you come on Saturday? I said, because it's Sabbath. Whether I was a preacher or not, it's Sabbath. Well, then the emotional and fiery furnaces started coming. Well, you came up for this one. And I said, yes, and it was on a Friday day, and we were back by Sabbath. Yeah, but there's no yeah about it. I am not going to bow before this Nebuchadnezzar thinking. I will be willing to go into the mental fiery furnace, the mental and emotional fiery furnace, and deal with what I got to deal with. And you can shut me down, shut me off, lock me out, or not talk to me. I will not bow. Because if I bow, there won't be a fourth man coming. But if I go in it, there's a fourth man that sustains me. So you either do that or you do this. Poof. You bow down in order to save your life. Pastor, is this not worth all my mental stress? Is this not worth all that I have to go through? Is this not worth it? Is he not worth it? That really is the question. Is he not worth it? Yes, ma'am. Where does it leave the Good Samaritan? Well, let's just say, out of 100, probably 1% of missing Sabbath is because you needed someone. Someone needed your help. 99% is because it's you thought they needed your help. Now we have to keep it in perspective. What's this man? This man's along the road dying. Yeah, that's a priority. Torah, life trumps Torah. Okay, but if the man is along the road and needs a coffee, and I stop to get him a coffee. That's not right. He's dying. Keep it in perspective. He's dying. He's been beaten. He's been bruised. He's been battered. Of course. Of course, that's the obvious. You don't walk over that person. But a birthday party is not of someone dying. Something else is not someone dying. We have to keep it in perspective. What does it mean? What? And for my sake, it was kind of a reception. Well, a reception is not dying. Especially when you could maybe make the choice of making it a different day, but you choose not to make it a different day to accommodate me. Not that you have to accommodate me, but if you don't want to accommodate me, then don't be mad at me. Don't give me mental and emotional accusation, because I'm not mad at you. Don't be mad at me. Do you understand what I'm saying? No, because we're coming in from, no. But you, again, you have to realize we're coming in. Okay, you happen to be blessed by having someone who doesn't work on Saturday. When they're coming in, sometimes you have to work your way into it or work your way out of it so that God can do something. Because if you're already in the situation, that's like saying you're married to an unbeliever and then you got saved. Because he's an unbeliever, do you ditch him? No, you work it out. So you pray, and we talked about it on Mother's Day, by your sanctification, by the way that you live your life. And so you live, and you maybe live a little while, and then maybe you ask, can I be off? And if they say no, and then maybe you look for another job, or you continue to ask, or you do a good job, and you ask again. And it's where your heart is trying to, okay? You're trying to obey that commandment. Because now, if you had a great job making great money and you work Monday through Friday, and then the devil brings you another job where you have to work every single Sabbath and every single Wednesday and gives you about $1,000 more, you're going to make a choice. And that choice is $1,000 worth the Sabbath and not being able to be at Bible study? So we'll throw that out, but you have to make those choices. And like a nurse is someone who's helping with life, and we do know that there are some jobs that will demand you to help. But again, as an example, I worked in a hospital for many, many years, and when I went to them and honestly just sat with them and said, listen, this is when we were doing Sunday, I really don't want to work Sunday, and I will really work every Saturday if you want me to, because I really need Sunday off. They accommodated me. They accommodated me because I was a good worker. They accommodated me because they wanted me. They accommodated me, well, I don't know why, favor of God or whatever. Sometimes we're just slow to ask and allow God to create a miracle. So I'm not saying that God's looking at you and saying, oh, wow, if you don't get out of here in 2 seconds, you're going to get it. But it's striving for, going after. And then God starts to change some things in our life, and maybe he would be able to release you from that Saturday job, right, and bring you to a place where you can do it. Or like Kyle, who comes, gets off early. He works for TSA, gets off early. I don't know if I was supposed to say that, but he gets off early. But then he goes back so that he can have Sabbath off, the Sabbath that's having here. So he's sacrificing until it opens up that maybe he could have off the whole time. So God sees him. God sees that he's making movements. God sees that he's sacrificing. And you'll not know what God has planned down to reveal or bring to them that will open up to be something powerful. Is that good? Is it okay? You there? It's good enough to stay? That's true. Well, I would say that. So, I mean, if you have faith, then quit the job and get something else. Well, but I'm with you then. I'm with you. I'm just trying, everyone's not the same faith. So I can't throw that out to everybody. But I do know that if push came to shove in my life, I probably would do that. But I don't want to put that, you understand what I'm saying? So I'm not trying to backpedal, but what I'm saying is I'm also a pastor who understands people's life and where they're at and where they're going and their finances. And sometimes people can stand for some things and sometimes we can't. There's areas of our life we can make a stand. We'll just say, I tell you what, I'd cut that off in a heartbeat. And then there's other areas of our life that we're not so strong in those areas. And God kind of helps us with that grace. It's not that he wants and okays it. It's just that he knows that we are imperfect and we live in an imperfect world. And it goes back to your heart. Now, if you'll want to and can, let me just say it this way. So if then they say you can work overtime on this day and then you say yes, your heart's already been revealed because you should say no to the overtime as opposed to the money. So, yes, if you're asking me, then we should just, yes. If it's black and white, it's black and white. But our lives are not always black and white. And I don't know where you're at in black and white. Do you know what I'm saying? So I'm giving allowances because I don't want everyone to walk out of here thinking, okay, I'm doomed, I'm going to hell. Pastor said so, and that's the way it is. No. I might not have. I'm at my stage of life because I had a earlier start than some. Right? I had an earlier start. Was anyone else born again at 6? I don't know. Younger? Filled with the Holy Ghost at 13? I mean, I didn't do any of those things that some of you did. I mean, I don't know what it is to have some of that stuff. Not saying that I'm perfect, but I didn't have all that stuff, and I don't have a lot of baggage and junk. And I learned, and through Gail and I's life, and she's seen it. I'm willing to stand up and say some stuff when I need to, and cut things off when I need to, and pay a price when I need to. But it comes with growth, and we're growing. We're growing. Next slide. Matthew 16:25-26. For whoever wants to save his own life will what? Destroy it. But whoever destroys his life for my sake will find it. What good will it do someone if he gains the whole world but forfeits his life? Or what can a person give in exchange for his life? That's a very powerful verse. And that verse is really talking about our everyday lives. Right? Our everyday lives. We have to ask ourselves this question sometimes. Is my soul for sale? And if so, for how much? What am I willing to just to surrender to the world, surrender to the things, surrender? If whatever the mark of the beast is, if they came in and said you need to take the mark of the beast or your family will starve, that's the challenge that we'll have to make a decision, won't we? And the decision at first would be easy. No way, no way. But can you stand there and watch your children or your grandchildren suffer in hunger and still make a stand? That's the price you have to start paying that many people before us have paid. That might sound appalling, but the truth of the matter is that every time we compromise the teachings of the Word of God for society's tradition, we place a price tag on the Word of God which resides inside of us. Listen, the Word is not always easy, and it's not always jelly beans and Kit Kats. For some reason, I must be hungry for a jelly bean and Kit Kat. It's hard to swallow sometimes, and it demands adjustment of our lives. And sometimes the adjustment of our lives takes time. If you remember when we started this journey with the Torah, we came to the conclusion what we were going to do, but then I said, in September, we will change. So, like, we came to the conclusion by June, but then we gave us a couple months to readjust ourselves. Now, that was because of grace and trying to get our mindset and change. I could have said, okay, now we know it. Tomorrow, we're doing it. But we needed to have a moment. We needed to get ourselves acclimated to what was going on. We, no matter what, have to maintain the mind of Yeshua to prevent our giving in to the unreasonable demand of the masses. That's why a lot of times I just marvel at Israel. You know, when, and I know you might be tired of hearing that, but, you know, if you all saw it on Holocaust Remembrance, the whole nation stops. Every car on an interstate stops, and they get out and stand for those 2 minutes. We see that a nation can do it. And isn't it interesting, if a nation can do it, I wonder why small churches can't do it. If a nation can do it, why can't we stand in unity as a small body of believers? Why can't we just agree to follow the word of God, even if the masses are not? But in order to do that, to maintain that mind of Christ, we first have to be introduced to him, Yeshua, as a living, breathing part of our existence, of your existence. Not just a sideliner, not just someone out there. He is woven in my life. That's what I was saying about Sister Gail and I, the commandments of God. They possess us. That it's woven in our lives. It's not something at a crossroads we choose to or not to do. It's woven. It has now become part of us. It is who we are. It is how we think. It is what our belief system is. It's embedded inside of us. And we would we would never, ever even think about not. So he has to be a breathing part of our existence. A lot of times he is the God who is there and who has the answers and who we come to, but we've not allowed him to penetrate us where it becomes part of us. Because this requires a change of mind, a change of a mindset and a way of thinking. And it's hard to change a mindset. We all understand that. It's hard to change our mindsets. Listen, the word is living and factual instructions on how to bind the curses and release the blessings of God over your life. And that's what we have to look at them. Remember, we said it before that the commandments are, if we follow them, are blessings. So we have to learn to understand to release those blessings by obedience to our lives. Now, if you break it, does he kick you out of heaven? Is it something that you're going to lose? Well, not necessarily out of heaven. But you know, Isaiah 66. Did you ever read Isaiah 66? Let me give you a little inkling of how we do things. If you turn to Isaiah 66, because I don't have it on the PowerPoint. If he finds it and puts it up, that would be great for you. But in Isaiah 66, see, sometimes we pick and choose some things. So if I started reading to you Isaiah 66, starting with verse 1, heaven is my throne, says Adonai, and the earth is my footstool. How many know that everyone on the earth that's a Christian knows that verse? And that's a very powerful verse. We would say amen to that, right? We'd be like, amen. What kind of home could you build for me? What sort of place? Oh, you got it? What sort of place could you devise for my rest? Didn't I make myself... make all these things, this is how they all came to be, says Adonai. The kind of person on whom I look with favor is the one with a poor and humble spirit. We say, amen, who trumps out my word. Hallelujah. Those others might as well kill a person as an ox, as well break a dog's neck and sacrifice a lamb. Go on down. and so I enjoy, go on. Look at verse 5. Hear the word of Adonai who tremble at his word. You brothers who hate you and reject you because of my name have said, let Adonai be glorified so we can see your joy. But they will be put to shame. That uproar in the city, that sound from a temple is the sound of Adonai repaying his foes what they deserve. Amen. Amen. I mean, these are good verses. Look at verse 10. Rejoice with Jerusalem. Roll it up if you can. Be glad with her, all you who love her. Rejoice. Rejoice with her, all you who mourn for her, so that your nurse are satisfied by comforting breasts, drinking deeply, delighting in the overflow of her glory. And Adonai says, I will spread. All that is great. Right? Your heart will rejoice at the sight. Your bodies will flourish like newly sprouted grass. Hallelujah. For look, Adonai will come in fire, and his chariots will be like the whirlwind. Oh, it's coming. It's the second coming. We're so excited. I mean, heaven is where he stays. His earth is a footstool. We're very excited about him coming like a whirlwind and rebuking with fiery, blazing fire. For Adonai will judge all humanity with fire and with a sword, and those slain by Adonai will be many. And I guarantee that all of us up to them will say amen, and every traditional church will say glory to God until you get to verse 17. Those who consecrate and purify themselves in order to enter the gardens, then follow the one who was already there eating pig meat, reptiles and mice will all be destroyed together, says Adonai, for I know their deeds and their thoughts. Well, that wasn't happy. He throws that in. Now we get back to the happy times. The time is coming when I will gather together all the nations and languages. They will come and see my glory, and I will give them. My only point in showing you that is that sometimes we pick and choose, oh, that sounds good, I want that. But then we ignore verse 17 that kind of says you really need to follow the things that I'm telling you to follow, even down to the food. Or there's a price to pay. Then we like this part, and then we go down to verse 23, and then traditional churches don't like this because every month on Rosh Hashanah and every week on Shabbat, everyone living will come to worship in my presence, says Adonai, which means when he returns, we will also have new moon services, and we will also have a Sabbath. And every month on Rosh Hashanah and every week on Shabbat, everyone living will come to worship in my presence, says Adonai. That's how important it is to him. So we got to stop picking and choosing. And sometimes it will require us to go into a fiery furnace of emotional and mental accusations and darts because people have a mindset, and sometimes it's even hard for us to get it because we also have a mindset, and having a mindset is hard to change. But what does God say? Renew your mind. By how? By the Word of God. So we have to learn to apply the Word of God daily and know that this is how you change your mind and your life. A mindset is having a mind that is set on a particular way of thinking, which is shaped by environments or environmental surroundings and embedded with the powerful influence of good and bad teachings. Moronic mindsets are minds that have been so contaminated with false teaching that they have been rendered incapable of receiving the truth. And that's when he says, why are you casting your pearl before swine? No pun intended. What he's saying is they have such a mindset that's been contaminated, they will never understand the truth. Unless who intervenes? Unless Yahweh does. And we're testimonies right here. So until he comes, that means everyone has a chance, right? Because we're living testimonies. Every parent understands the power of persuasion. Every one of us that has a child, we know we've been trying to persuade our children to do right, right? Whether it was candy, whether it's with discipline, right? Whether it's with car keys. And the responsibility that each of us has to properly steer a child toward a well-balanced way of thinking is ours. We have that responsibility. This is why I say I know within the next 5 years there's going to be a massive exodus, maybe not even 5 years, a massive exodus from the public school. Has to be. If you look at the curriculum, there has to be for us who are born again and love the Lord, there's going to have to be a massive exodus because you cannot afford to lose your children to the standard of thinking and the mindset that's going to be placed on them while they're in public school. Impossible. Impossible. And we have to learn to have to pay that price, right? And there will be emotional and mental. I mean, let's face it, when you first don't have gifts and do Christmas, the whole thing is, oh, I can't believe you're doing that to your children. I can't believe your grandchildren will ever experience that. I can't believe it. Mental. Because if you're not careful, you start thinking, I know, I had the presents, and I don't know what happened. I mean, if you're not careful, right? Are you telling me that they can't get a basket and go find an egg? Oh, right. Now, that egg is going to send them to hell. Then it starts. You've hunted eggs, and look where you are. You're okay. And you're thinking, I'm okay. I hunted an egg. I ate a chocolate bunny. But here's what I didn't know, the things that I know now, right? And it's not about whether you get harmed by it or not get harmed by it. This is where we don't get it. The thing is, did he say to do it or did he say not to do it? It has nothing to do with harm. I said it over and over again. Pork chops are good. They're delicious. Can I get an amen? They're good. For those of you who like shrimp, shrimp is good. For those of you who like crab, I can't stand it. But to you, it's good. Lobster is good to you. He didn't say it wasn't good. Sin is good. The way it makes you feel, how you know what I'm saying? A good party, a good high, a good drunk. I don't know any of those things, but they make you all look like you have good times. Get your buzz on. Oh, I love to be buzzed. I'm just saying, it's not something that makes you feel bad. Now, maybe afterwards, if you drank too much, you're throwing up and giving sacrifices to the ivory bowl. But other than that, it's the only deterrent is that you want to be obedient to God and you love Him, and that's the deterrent. And that's what it should be for all of us. But it's just, how can it be wrong when it tastes so right? Our thinking is contaminated. Some of us have moronic mindsets in areas of our lives. Exodus chapter 33, 1 through 3. Adonai said to Moses, "Leave you and the people who brought you up out of the land of Egypt and move on from here toward the land of which I swore to Abraham." And then we already know what he says. He says, "I'm not going with you all because you are such a stiff-necked people." And then he tells you why he's not gone. Because I might destroy you on the way. So what he's basically saying is, I'd rather stay here and send you, because if I go with you and you keep acting the way you acting, you're dying. What he was saying to them is that your life is out of order. And when your life is out of order, it brings death to you. Whether he kills you or not, to be out of order brings death to you. They had disorderly lifestyles. They had crops that were not able to produce because they had not the right ground, right? They had giants in the land that they would never be able to overcome. And in fact, in Exodus 3:8, and this kind of goes with what I was saying the other couple weeks or last week, I don't remember when it was, but Exodus, do the next Exodus, Exodus chapter, I didn't do that one, did I? Sorry about that. Exodus 3:8, he makes a promise, and when he makes a promise to them, go to Numbers 13:28, let's go there. Numbers 13:28, however, the people living in the land are fierce, and the cities are fortified and very large. Moreover, we saw the Anakims there, and these Anakim are giants that are referred to the descendants of Anak, known hirelings who disrupt and cause chaos in the lives of the people of Yahweh. So they were going to have to deal with these specific people who were placed in their life to always cause chaos in their life. Do you know that there are giants in your life that are placed there by the enemy to always cause chaos in your life? And before they could lay hold of the claim to the promise, they had to bring order to the promised land. Let me make this a spiritual thing for us. Skip Numbers 33. Let's go to the spiritual thing. What happens to us is this. We've allowed disorder in our lives, and therefore we will never be able to reach our promised land. We are now responsible for making order come into our lives. Let's go back to, I'm sorry about it. Go to Numbers 33. Just go back a slide. Let me see where I want to read it. Okay. I don't know how to say it. Spoke to Moses in the plains of Moab by the Jordan or the Jordan across from Jericho. He said to tell the people of Israel, when you cross the Jordan into the land of Canaan, you are to what? Read it with me. Number 52. You are to expel all the people living in the land from in front of you. You are to destroy all their stone figures, destroy all their metal statues, and demolish all their high places. 53, drive out the inhabitants of the land and live in it, for I have given the land for you to possess. Now remember, I preach that if they would have done it 40 years earlier, it would already been done for them, but because they lacked faith, came in late. You all do understand that if you would have came in at 2 and 3 years old and really followed the word of God with all your heart, you wouldn't have as many giants in your land. Right? But because we've allowed giants in our land, who now is responsible to get them out? Mr. Robert says, me. I'm responsible to get all your giants out. Every one of you are responsible. I am responsible to get those giants out. And he tells the people, when you cross it, before you can settle in it, before you can live in it, before it will be yours, here's what you got to do. Get rid of those things that cause disorder in your life. Now go on down, because here's what he says in verse 55. But if you don't drive out the inhabitants of the land from in front of you, remember, he says that twice, in front of you, then those you allow, say it with me, then those you allow, those that you allow to remain will become like thorns in your eyes and stings in your sides, and they will harass you in the land where you are living. Man, this seems to be a thorn in my flesh. Man, this, because you have some sort of disorder in your life and you have not taken the time to order that life, and therefore you are causing distress on your own, and you have caused your own eyes to be stung with thorns and your own sides to be hit with those stings because you're still allowing things in your life that's not supposed to be there. He already gave them the land, but told them to get rid of every trace of ungodly tradition and religion before inhabiting their land flowing with milk and honey. If we would learn just to get rid of old things are passed away. Behold, all things become new. Now, we all know that's not an instant thing. We would like it. We know it's an instant thing when it comes to our sins, at least at that moment. He has washed away our sins, right? And we start brand new. But we also know when we left the altar and start walking, some of those things keep cropping, coming back that we have to say, oh, no, that's not right. We have to get rid of that. Oh, that thinking is not right. We have to get rid of that. Oh, that tradition is not right. We have to get rid of that. That only comes through the Word of God. It only comes through relationship. And it only comes if you really want the promised land that God has for you. But it takes effort. It takes fiery furnaces. It'll take a lion's den. It'll take a prison sentence. It'll take a pit, right? So my question for you as I wrap this up is, what giant is occupying your land of promise? What giant is occupying your land of promise? Listen, it's not the trials that you experience along the way that will destroy you. It's the way you react in the midst of those trials. It's the lessons you learn or fail to learn that will ultimately determine whether or not you enjoy the fruits of your promised land. You either learn it or you don't learn it, and if you don't learn it, you have to do it again. And the longer you don't learn it, the more disorder that's in your life, right? And the more disorders in your life, you can't ever reach your promised land because those giants have been set in your life to harass you. Now we can, oh yes, I know that sister's my giant, that brother's my giant. Before you start pointing on the outside, let's look in the inside. What giants in your life are stopping you from receiving? Because actually the outer ones are just pushing the buttons of the inner ones. If you can get the inner ones in order, you'd be surprised how many giants will drop dead before you. God is about to bring order to what he has already anointed you to do. I believe that one of the reasons why I'm talking about this new season again is because God's about ready to bring some order to us. But first, he has to strip you of some things that you may be properly adorned to fill your position in the kingdom. Because some of the clothes and some of the things that you are wearing, and I'm talking spiritually, are not conducive to the kingdom. And he has to get you to remove them. Regardless of what you have been gifted to do, and this is a very important slide. I want you to listen to it and maybe take a note or two off of it. Regardless of what you've been gifted to do, if you don't have order, that gift or talent will do more harm to you than good. If you have a great talent, you don't have order, and then you give that talent to the world, it will do more harm to you. That talent that you had is doing more harm to you than good because you are out of order. And people have been sucked into the world because they hadn't had order in their life and been consumed by the world and become like the world. Now, I only know this because I saw an interview. Like, I don't mean to drop names, but Katy Perry. She was a worship leader. She led worship in her father and mother's church. Huh? Well, I'm saying, then her life got out of order, and she went after what? Fame and different position. Now look at her. This talent, this gift of worship to bring people into the presence of God, this charisma, this this voice, this instrument that could bring people to the place of God is now bringing people to the place of the enemy. Because her life got out of order, and when it got out of order, it started to do harm. So that's why every gift and every talent should be used for his kingdom and for his glory. God wants to place you in a position of trust where you can hear his voice and obey his commands without questions. And we often cannot hear the voice of God because of the traditions we've been taught and our past environments speak louder than his truth. Now, as a leader, I represent the voice of God that leads you to the source. But for complete order, you're the one that has to bring order to your life. I can't. I can bring you to the source, but you have to take that initiative to bring order to your life. I cannot. You can say, Pastor, help me. What can I do? I can tell you what the source is, but you have to start making choices where you choose God over emotions, feelings, thinking processes, opinions, other people's opinions, what feels good. Your desire, God has to override all those things. And it might seem that the Lord has given you a hard thing to do. Like Sister Norma was pointing out, it seems to be very hard. So some of those black and white things seem to be very hard, especially where we're coming from. Because God didn't go to Egypt and call his perfect people. He called a people who lived in Egypt for 400 and some years who were involved in their gods and involved in the things of that life and had experienced hardship. So he picked people who were not necessarily the cream of the crop to bring them to a place. That means they had to do some stuff within them to get them to the place where they needed to be. That's us. That's why he says, work out your own salvation with what? Fear and trembling. It doesn't mean you choose how to live your life. It means that as you walk your life, all of us are different. All of us are experiencing things. All of us are going through different things. And therefore, we have to come to the place where we work that out in our lives to the salvation of Adonai and the fear of him. And sometimes it takes a little while, right? Listen, if your child was out just playing for a little bit in the evening, when you come in, the bath is easy. If they've been in mud, if they've been rolling around, how many know the bath is long? And I remember a couple times, because my children love to be outside, we had to change water for the same bath. You know, you got the top part done. You're like, Lord, drain it and start it back up again, because you know you couldn't do the bottom part because it was just like dirt. Well, some of us get a quick shower, depending on what that moment is in our life, and some of us, God says, come, get in the bathtub, and he has to change the water. Change the water. Change the water. Two things. He may require that you make some drastic changes in your life, such as losing some ungodly ties. That's always hard, isn't it? To cut some things off, and change some things up in your life. Maybe the place you used to go, you don't go no more. Maybe who you used to hang with, you don't hang no more. Maybe that place that always seems to capture you and bring that thought pattern up, you can't go there no more. Even if all your friends go there, that's some drastic changes in your life. Even those who have some sort of an addiction, and I know some of you have experienced that or going through that, one of the things that they tell you to do is you can't go back to the same places. Listen, if you're an alcoholic, you can't visit the bar anymore just to see your friends. You're going to have to meet your friends somewhere else. Because going back to the bar just perpetuates the problem. The atmosphere, the same thing. He also may place you in a season of boredom, where there's nothing you can do except seek the face of God, which is what we hate because we just want to be active. I want to do something for God, or I don't see what I can do for God. Why can't I do this for God? What's going on with my life? I seem like I'm lost. I seem like I'm not there. It could just be a season of boredom because God just wants you to seek him. Now, and I'll close with this. Moses grew up in a what? In a palace. When you think of growing up in a palace, there's queens and princesses, people coming in, nations going out. He was in the circle of activity. Come on. Ate at the nice tables. There was guests out there. I mean, there was a president over here. There's a king from over here. There's a queen from over there. I mean, you can't get any other active life than being, part of the royal family. So hallelujah. I mean, he went in, he went out. Probably had chariots he could choose from. I want that chariot. I want that chariot. I want that horse. I want this horse. I mean, his life was just spectacular. Then, of course, we know something happens. And where does he go? He spent 40 years there. And then where does he go for 40 more years? You don't think that's the spirit of boredom all of a sudden? That's like going from, New York City to Crewe. You know what I'm saying? You're like, wow, let's go to Broadway. Where am I at Crewe? Okay, they don't have Broadway. That's okay. Where's the movies? They don't have movies. What do they got? Go outside. There's some deer running. Take someone from a New York and just, I mean, not working their way in, just remove them and send them, boom, there you go. It's a spirit of boredom, right? But the spirit of boredom is where you can seek the face of God, because too much activity makes you focus on the activities and not God. And maybe you are in a spot where you need to see the face of Adonai, so therefore he shuts things down. No wonder when that burning bush was burning, Moses was like, oh, there's a burning bush. Let me go see it. I haven't seen anything else. Look. I see some fire over there. He was intrigued. But what happens to him after that? He spends the next years, 40 years. Woo. Come on. Seas parting, bugs jumping, frogs croaking, leading people, billions of people across. Come on. In the middle of that activity, in the middle of this activity, was a spirit of boredom. But it was a place where he would see God. Okay. Scratch your head, you're like, yeah. So, we're in a new season. So, get ready and hold on, because God wants to do something in your life. Just get rid of some of those trashy traditions and those things in your life that are going to hinder you from the promised land. Amen? Questions? Hallelujah. Let's stand before Adonai. No, I don't. I know I'm trying not to eat holes. I appreciate it, though. Actually, yes, give me one, please.